Presenter of our main talk today is someone I think probably many or most of you, without realizing, are familiar with her work, because her artwork graces the signs and buildings all over our fair city and makes it a much, much more beautiful place. She's incredibly talented, and she has a great story to tell and some wonderful artwork to show you. Let's give a warm Houston Oasis welcome to Anat Ronan.
I'm an artist, a professional artist, urban artist, street artist, I'm an introvert, but I share the same values you do. As introverts, we congregate toward ourselves and the cats at home. So we don't have community life. Let me open.
As an introvert, we congregate.
What's happening? My story is interesting, mainly interesting to you, because I started this path in my life only 8 years ago. I am not trained. I never went to school for this. I didn't do it before as a professional artist, and I started this as a way of staying in the United States. I'm an immigrant. So today is like a big deal. An immigrant. My parents were immigrants. My grandparents were immigrants. My great-grandparents were immigrants. So it's not a big deal, but. So this is me. I was born almost 46 years ago to my in Israel. I'm from Israel. My parents immigrated from Uruguay, South America. Their parents immigrated from Eastern Europe before and after the war. I have two younger brothers. One of them is a musician, professional musician in Israel, and the other is saving the world one person at a time. I have one son, Or, he's 21. I have a husband and six cats. I never went to college. Impatient at school. I guess today it's called HDD or whatever. I was never diagnosed, but I never liked school. I never liked to sit down and study. So I didn't go to college. In Israel, you have to go to the army to serve the army for 2 years, and you get like this big, like good dose of how life is gonna be. So that kind of, and plus my mother passed when I was 19. She had cancer, very brief and very violent, and she was dead in 2 months, and it left us all with this, what the hell just happened? The whole three of us, me and my two younger brothers, we kind of took a different path. So it wasn't like the path that we were supposed to take, like going to the army and then going to college and then starting life and building a family and all that. And yeah, we all kind of took different turns. So I was just making a living in offices, kind of financial institutions. But I always did stuff to kind of complement what I was doing. So this is kind of a little bit example of what I was doing back in the day. It was not digital. It's weird. It was a long time ago, like 25 years ago. Just illustrations, murals for friends, but really, I can maybe count them in one hand, all the murals that I did before I started this different path in my life. This was all in Israel. I never, ever, ever thought that I was going to do any of this in a professional way. I never thought I had anything in me that people would actually want to pay me for. So it wasn't even in my, there wasn't any place that this was even a dream. You know, a lot of speakers will come to you and tell you, hey, follow your dream, you know, and do this and do that. And I'm like, I didn't have that dream. But I have another dream. In 2005, me and now my husband, we came for a visit. We had our first in 7 years vacation, and we came to the United States, and we fell in love. We fell in love mostly with the size of the United States. It's weird to say, I don't know who of you were in Israel, but Israel is very, very tiny. It's the size of New Jersey, they say, I think. And everybody knows everybody, and you really can't go out of who you are. It's like a small town kind of feel, but an entire country. And my husband comes from an even tinier little village that everybody knows everything about everybody, even before they were born. It's weird. So we really were looking for somewhere that we can start fresh, nobody knows us, nobody, you know, just start. And so it was very complicated, and it's even more complicated now with all the laws and immigration laws and so forth. And we got this visa to come. I was working for a real estate investor in Miami, again, not doing nothing artistic, nothing at all. So I came with a visa. It meant that my husband could work as well. It was that kind of a visa. We spent a few months in Miami. We didn't quite like it because it's more of like a South American city. We tried Michigan. We didn't like that either. I mean, it's very pretty. You see, it's white and beautiful, but no. It didn't work out there. I don't know if I can curse here, there's children. Oh, okay, so we got screwed. And we don't have some money, so we didn't know. We were kind of saying, okay, maybe it's a sign for us to just go back and close that dream off. Or try another place, and we decided to come here, basically. We were like, okay, just one more try, you know, a place that is not Michigan, for sure, with the climate, affordability was key, and a lot of people that will mean opportunity. And we had no idea what it's gonna be, but we're like, okay, let's try there, see what happens. I was here still working on that visa with that person from Miami, outsourced to me, but that visa, and I tell that, I don't know how many of you know about the visa, but visa is very much like being, having a visa is like having a pimp, basically. It's not, I mean, it's funny, but it's not, because the visa, the sponsor is responsible for your work, and if he doesn't need you anymore, you're screwed. I mean, you have to go back or find another sponsor, which is very, very complicated. So, and I couldn't leave with that because I'm a very independent person, and I could not leave with the thought that somebody is gonna say to me, you know, at one point or the other, we don't need you anymore. So we said, okay, another try, kind of Hail Mary, let's try for another visa that will break free from everybody else. And if that works, great. If not, we can, you know, we'll go back home, and that's it. So I applied for an O-1. O-1 is for extraordinary ability people, like actors and musicians and athletes and artists. And I just gathered like everything I've ever done since high school, and it worked. I have no idea how. There's all kinds, the immigrant world, there's all kinds of companies or advisors or even not even law offices that kind of give you this package. Hey, we're going to get you this for $5,000, $10,000, just, you know, follow us, you know. Legal and all, but anyway, it worked. I'm good. I'm happy. I was stunned at that moment that I got it because I was super happy, for sure, but also super scared because I had no idea how to do it. I mean, I was not a professional artist until then. I had no education, nothing. It was like a great little, I don't know, hole that opened up, and either you jump or you don't. It was very peculiar. So I started using Craigslist for I advertised that I do graphic design and web design and illustrations and murals, because I did a few murals back home in Israel. And I got very peculiar gigs out of it, very, very interesting. I blocked them off, but very interesting, let's say. I mean, Craigslist is becoming more and more strange, but it was always there. It was always strange. So these, what you see here is pretty later in the day when I found out that mural work is something that you can't really outsource. Mural is here. You can't really call for somebody from China or India to do the mural that you have to do here. So this was my first mural in Houston. It was funny because that was a Jewish family. I'm Jewish because I was born Jewish. I'm not at all religious. Actually, I call myself atheist. So that family as well. They weren't Jewish, but they were from Jewish origins. And they waited 7 years for somebody to come and do this, no pressure. And I was the one. So I was like, okay. It took, what I did is just, I did stuff. I do stuff still. You know, I just, if it doesn't work, no big deal. It's not that I'm not building bridges and I'm not building buildings. I'm just painting. So worst case scenario, you just paint over it. You don't pay me. We call it quits. That's about it. So that's my motto. It's not as scary as it may sound. A few months after, I got a call from a national company that paints roads. I don't know if you know, but all the roads around us are painted in ugly colors, sometimes interesting little details. And that company used to kind of insert little art projects here and there as a bonus to their generous federal sponsors or clients. And so I did, I don't know if you know, the causeway between the causeway to Galveston. There's four long murals on each side, two on each end of the causeway. I did that. Looking back, it was the weirdest ever. I mean, you stand there, it was January, it was cold, it was in the middle of the road, people pass you by like 80 miles per hour. It was weird. But doing this really taught me a lot about what I can do, and if I can do it, and if what I see, my vision, can be actually transformed into actual mural, actual visual work. So through that company, we had me and my husband, by now we got the new visa, it meant that I only could work, my husband could not work. He was just my dependent, and so we had to rely entirely on what I do. And so to places like this that I needed help, he would come with me and basically be with me. So a lot of weird projects for sure, weird locations like this. Yeah, that was a special request by the architect or the designer of that weird bridge. Project that it will be painted also on the inside. Nobody's ever going to see it, but he got it. I can't tell you. It was a fun time. It was 2 years, and the company needed an artist because their in-house artist was Russian, here on a visa as well, but then he decided to go visit his family in the middle of his green card process, and he forgot to tell the government about it, so he was stuck in Russia for 2 years. Yeah, that's something you don't do if you're, another project, this is something that you may have seen on the way to Galveston. This was 2010, that was my last project with them. Probably seen it, yeah. This is not my design, this is by a design, some artist that did a lot of NASA work, so that was kind of a homage to the Bay Area, business center. And I did this in 3 days each side. And every time I did this, it was like, okay, I'm getting here, that I'm quick, that I can get a good product, and so that will take me further to, you know, where I want to go. This is my this was my biggest commercial gig, my first commercial gig. It was, I think, you've probably seen it too. It's in Midtown. It's a bar. It's a very fancy bar, very beautiful on the inside. And the owner, my approach there was that I have no idea what I'm doing, but let me try. I'll give you a good price, so it will be kind of a tuition in a sense. You're not paying full price. I don't have to pay you, but I kind of okay. Let's see what happens. And I was pleased that it turned out nice. Of course, now I can't look at it because now I'm kind of light years ahead of that. But he was happy, still in touch with me, and that worked out well. This is like a 77 feet long by 14, and it took about 10 days because it was basically not full days. But I realized from project to project that my strength is by doing things faster than other people would do, mostly because I don't know what I'm doing. So I just do it. Because other people, they're like, oh, no, I would do this first and this after and this and that. I just get it off. And then also I have no patience, so it's kind of it is what it is. 2000, and then all sorts of stuff started coming my way. This was weird looking back even now, because I was by no means either known or had too much experience. But then this is by Neiman Marcus. They had this, I don't know if they have it still, they have a month between Thanksgiving and Christmas where they give pets for adoption, and it's in the Galleria. So it was a very good exposure. Not good money, but good exposure. I had this, probably you've seen it too. It's by the Minute Maid Park. That was strictly commercial. I mean, there was, you may look at it and say, it's not artistic at all. I mean, it's not fun, but just because it's not artistic, it is fun, because it was fun kind of trying to go for the real, you know, bottle look and all that, so it was fun. This is just to show you the dimensions of it. Me working on the label that was later. It was at first it was Big Red Diet, and then it was Zero. I had to go back and change the label. It was bizarre. Things are, I mean, the stories I have to tell. Sometime along the line, I got introduced to street painting, which is chalk on the ground. There's a big, big festival in downtown Houston the weekend before Thanksgiving, Via Glory, and I won this kind of a weird, it wasn't a contest even, it was kind of a radio station kind of thing, and they sent me, they were my sponsor, and I was like, okay, let's try it, worst case scenario, you know, it doesn't work. Again, with the same mentality of, let's see. The year after, I was asked to be a part of this huge, huge project, that I did, so I learned more, and that is chalk, it's a different medium. Again, I have no idea what I'm doing, but I just do it. Sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't, but. By this time, we kind of separated with that company that paints the roads, and I started working with HISD, which is huge. It's a huge client. It's not that you work with them and the work is granted, it's just you have to find the work. I mean, people have to find you, you have to find the work, so you are approved to work with them, but it's not that work just flows your way. But it was a new channel, and it was a new direction, and I welcomed it, because when the road painting company kind of broke up with us, it was kind of abrupt, and it was weird. We kind of left without any, it was uncalled for anyway, but it's all good. I mean, I have nothing. I think, you know, throughout the years, all the years that I've done, I received many negative responses along the way until I started doing art. So I think it kind of shaped the way to where I started going, and I think it's great. I respect every note that I've ever got. So this was a school project. This was a school project, it's Garden Oaks. If you know the entire school, Another thing that I learned is that I underbid, like, big time. It's a no problem. I didn't invent the wheel here, but I did, like, their entire school for, like, peanuts. And it was just, the projects that never end, it takes a toll on you. More schoolwork. This is a part of a huge library. It's in Lake City. And here I got the best compliment I've ever got. There was a teacher. It was spring break. There was nobody there. There was a teacher. She came along after a few days. And she's like, can I tell you something? And I'm like, sure. And she's like, well, I have to tell you that I was really against this project because, you know, like, we can use the money in other directions. But I'm seeing what you do, and I really appreciate it. So that was a really good compliment because first you didn't have to even say anything. I mean, I'm nothing. But yeah, and she told me about her change of mind so much that she had to tell me that. So I really, it was quite an amazing thing. So that was a fun thing. It was entirely freehand. I was, as I went, I had no idea what it was. I mean, I knew generally what I was going to do, but I had no idea what exactly would come up from my head that morning. I did a few more stuff like that around school just to kind of complement everything together. And it turned out really fun. That's me working on some. So little by little, it became clear that, you know, whatever things I take upon myself, it's not going to be the usual, you know, kind of the first one that I showed you, you know, the big logo. I was kind of drifting away from that, and I went more to play to things that would make me more interested in doing. The next one, this was a straight up just a name mural, but because it's a Montessori, I was like, let's build your name out of your building blocks or whatever the things that they use for the education. I don't know even how to call it. But so I went to their classroom and I put stuff together, took some photos and built that, and it was so much more fun than just the name. That's another school mural by 45 and Scott, you've probably seen it. It was a school, a Dodson Elementary, and then it was closed, turned into a high school. In that area, it's the third ward, there's a lot of kind of, they close schools, they're trying to kick people out, so basically they're not too keen. From this project was born another project that you'll see later that is my biggest so far. So that was the Dodson. It's still there. The habitants in the neighborhood voted to leave it in space, so only the name was erased, but the mural is still there. So it's visual from the 45. I had the visa in 2008, but visas are temporary. So you really have to think what you do next. And the next was the green card. And to get the green card, I needed to try harder for being that extraordinary person or ability person that they wanted to see. And it's a lot more complicated than getting the visa, so I really needed to shoot high, to be in newspapers, in magazines, to go places, to be invited to shows, to be out there. You know, I'm an introvert, I told you, so it's not easy. So what I did, I started to go to street painting and street art festivals. And this was my first mural in a festival. I showed up with five brushes, and that's it. And it was quite intimidating at first because I had no idea. So far, I had my husband. He helps me with everything, and that's great around the Houston area. But if I have to fly, I'm completely by myself. So I wasn't sure what's going to happen. But happily, it went good. So that was the first of that. That was the first time I kind of touched the street art aspect of it. Suddenly, I realized how much power you have when you put stuff on the street, when you place stuff. And now, by now, I'm doing a little more. I know that I can do a little more. I know that I can whatever I envision, I can put in on the wall or on the canvas or wherever. So why don't you, why don't I use it for stuff that is more meaningful? And so that basically that thought started up right then. This is another, so kind of locating stuff randomly in places. It's fun. I mean, I do it until now, and it's very fun. I also did more and more chalk or different mediums. I try things, again, because I don't know. I'm like a kid. I tell people I'm like this volcano that, although the lava was kind of gathered like beneath the ground, and now it's going up. So it's fun to be, I'm kind of old. not that old, but I'm 46 now, so it's not like, typical 20-year-old that starts and has all that energy, but it's still preserved in me, so it's kind of, I'm kind of young. I don't feel old anyways, but it's kind of complicated. That's in that Via Colori, the street painting festival here. Then I started getting gigs around the world for street painting. This is a 3D, what we call, which is actually a distorted image that's from a certain angle. It looks like it's standing on the ground. The girl is the girl is real. Yeah. Well, the best is when you got that. That's. This is another project in Oregon. So I started kind of traveling the U.S. and the world and did all kinds of stuff with street painting and then also with mural work. This is Austin, this is San Diego, Israel. I even went to Israel to do my... It's so weird, I have to tell you, that it's one of the most bizarre things to go back to the life you had before that you were not an artist. And it's like two different worlds that collide, because back then, back there, I'm the secretary or whatever I was, just a nobody basically, I'm here, but it's kind of, I'm not an artist over there, and doing art over there is messing with my brain big time. So I do it, and this year I'm supposed to be doing it again, but it's weird. So little by little, what I did is I had all those paying gigs, because obviously I needed to pay the bills. So schools paid for that, and residentials, and all kinds of businesses. And then I did a little more and more street art. So this is a big structure in the south of Houston that we kind of use for graffiti and all kinds of street art. It's no longer operating as such, because of a tragedy, never mind. But it was a good canvas to work on and to practice. So that was the first one in Houston, big. This was the whole thing I really wanted to try out. Again, that is something I never did before, the portrait stuff. I was sure I will never do portraits. But I started doing very small. This is like very tiny, and little by little it grew to a larger size, as you saw here. I did participate in a museum show in the Station Museum. And the Station Museum, I don't know who knows about the Station, so they're very political.
Yes.
And the owner is pro-Palestinian. I don't know how many of you know, but Israel. I'm very, I see myself as a liberal, but I really want everybody to live and be happy, and I'm not like one side against the other, but he's very much so. So we had a little bit of a collision when I presented my idea to him, or when I first went there to kind of be interviewed. And there was a big fight, or he yelled at me, and other artists that were there were kind of afraid, but were scared for me. But ultimately, I told him, listen, do you want my art? Do you want to argue with me? What do you want? He said, oh, no, I want you to do this. So this was born. And this was really the breakthrough for me. I mean, there were a lot of breakthroughs, but I think the breakthrough for kind of channeling all this that I have in me, that I realize now that I have in me, into actually putting things out as a message. Amazing feeling, because it's like, because all of us have something to say, but not all of us have the means to do that. And I have this amazing means to do that through my brush. So it's it was quite amazing. After that, this is another kind of political statement that you'll see soon. This is it. It was it's funny, because as much as you may think about it or kind of try to round the corners, there's always going to be people who won't get it. But it's just the way it is. So I had some weird comments. And now I kind of live with it, and I expect all kinds of weird, you know, things, because people sometimes have really no clue. But sometimes too, they do, so that's a good thing. But the good thing about the street art is that you go out, you know, you do that, you leave, it's up there, boom. It's still there, by the way. It's the same structure I did the big portrait, but now it's some kind of a business over there. In between, I did more and more schools and stuff like that. And again, I took it to places that I want to take it, not precisely what they want to take it. Because I'm Israeli, and we're kind of, yeah, we have this temper. It's funny, because this school, oh well, I'll show you later, never mind. This was another gig. This was 17 rooms that I was, I don't know why, I underbid, like there's no tomorrow there. It's a private school. I don't know. I mean, sometimes you look back and you're like, anyway. Another school. So each room had a theme. This was basically the last room, and it was a train. And I was like, there's, and I underbid so bad that I needed to do it in 2 to 3 days tops. So. Here comes the train, and I was petrified, because I'm like, there's no way I'm gonna do a train, because there's so many different details and the you know. So the data I remember vividly, because I was like, I was coming to that room with all the paint, I had no idea what I'm gonna do. And then I'm like, you know what, train? It doesn't mean that it has to be a real train, it can be a toy train. And then boom, you know, it kind of hit me. So it was kind of, you know, out from the blue, but it taught me again to kind of follow my intuition and my natural kind of direction and go with that, because probably that would be the better solution.
Probably not.
I don't know. Sometimes yes, sometimes no. This is another, again, street art. I like to kind of do everything, so it keeps me fresh. You know, when I don't do street painting, I do murals. When I don't, you know, when I do smaller stuff, so I take a vacation from the other mediums. And so it really helps me go forward and grow in each. I even was called to go paint in Disney World, which was, it was quite amazing. It was an amazing opportunity. Not so much when you come to think about it, because Disney obviously did everything imaginable, literally. And then you're called to do something and you're like, but what can I possibly do to bring new to the table? I mean, there's nothing. So I opted for the classics. I was the only one who did it on the wall. It was a freshly painted wall, so what they did, it was just a weekend-long festival. Afterwards, they just painted over it. But it was fun nonetheless, because really, I mean, all the other artists, they were doing it on the ground, so that was good. That was Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs, and you see how it's, you know, how I did it, like from sketch to color, so people were really amused. They said, their comments, that it looked like the real animation. Of course, that's bullshit. Anyway, yeah, the squirrel is my addition, so that was my. Then, yeah, more commission work. This was funny. I know this will take longer, so I hope you're good. Yeah, have time.
It's okay.
Really?
Yeah.
That's like, really?
We go back and forth.
So I'll do it fast? Okay. Clients sometimes are very stubborn. Okay? Sometimes they know what they want, or they think they know what they want, and then they don't. So here, this is a Fiesta store in Conroe, and the construction, the matter, I don't know, whatever it was, he was like, well, we want something else. Do you know those stickers that go on the produce, on grocery shops, stores? They wanted something like that, only on the bottom half. And I'm like, no, you have a whole stucco building. Let's do something nice. And he was like, no, we just want the one that is. I'm like, no. So what happened is they sent emails back and forth. I was showing him what he wanted and what I wanted and what he wanted and what happened. And he would send me pictures and I'm like, no. Finally, after 10 emails back and forth, he was like, okay, you can do what you want. So that was about it. So that was on one side and the other, the Fiesta. And the Fiesta, I'll do it quickly now. So that's more chalk, fun chalk, tape chalk. Most of them, I kind of, those are like a few hours each, so it's kind of a community event here and there. This is a 3D, so it's elongated. This is 3D as well on the canvas. This is kind of a rug. So the back of the armadillo is actually very stretched. So residential, fun residential, that's not too far from here. The owner of the fence, he contacted me and he was like, well, I really want to do this, a 60-foot fence, and I have two chihuahuas who really hate cats. What can you do? So, yeah. More residential, more. Oh, this was a mental institution. And that's like a quiet room for the kids. That was weird, for sure. That was an interesting story, but we don't have time. That's a street art. That's a street that...
I'm being really nice.
That street art proper means no funding, no money. It was done over 4 days. The flowers added because after the first day, it was tagged. Like the whole thing was tagged. And I was like, And I posted it on Facebook and then somebody told me, listen, this is exactly what they want. They want attention, so don't mention it. Put it down as if it never happened before. And I did. And so I was like, how can I fight that? And I'm like, okay, I'm gonna put a flower. I'm gonna fight them with flowers. So that was it. This one is like across the road. Yeah. Sometimes painting the old murals have their life of their own because I never expected any exposure out of it, but it kind of went around the world a few times. That's a fun. It was a fun street art gig for a private collector. So I was given complete freedom to do whatever I want, and I did. That's a street project combined with the zoo. So that was fun as well. They wanted to promote their new exhibit, gorilla exhibit, and the 5 street artists were chosen to do murals around the city. So that was it. More street art. I'll do it quick. Here. I'll do it. Oh, this is the big one that I told you before. That's 55 portraits of people from the street in the third world. That was all people that came up to me in the street and I took their picture. And that's just for size. So you can see. And I even put myself in here. And to this day, I had a call a few months ago from the person that stands right beside me, and he was calling me. He was like, "Well, I just wanted to know if this is your phone number because I want to give you a number to my I don't know what minister, priest, whatever." And I'm like, "Sure." And he was like, "I really wanted to tell you, there's some people that are very upset with you." And I'm like, "Why? What happened?" was like, well, because you use that space for you, not somebody else. No, but that's okay. They take it. So, yeah, I was working there. Another school project. That was another client that the principal was really not taking. I mean, she had. And so I was like, no, but I want to do this. And she was like, no, but I'm like, no, but I want to do this. So eventually it worked, and everybody's talking, all the custodians. I'm now working on another school, and they're like, oh, you did the dragon, yes. So that was the, that's in the cafeteria. So they have some appetite out of it, you know. Do you want it hot? I have this project too. I'm a part of this project. This is the mini murals or the traffic light boxes around town. So I did quite a few of them. I went to China to paint pandas in China. That is quite funny, I think. I was in travel, and I do festivals around the world. Okay, the next one is fun. You have to give them a couple of minutes. So this is, I do 3D street painting on the floor, and this would show you how that works right there. So you see, from one angle, it looks like 3D, but from any other angle, it doesn't look like 3D. So that's the trick. A lot of people ask. And that was a lot of fun. It was it's a big festival. A lot of people, they have all kinds of awards and stuff like that. But this was pretty straightforward, so obviously I wasn't going to win nothing. But people were having so much fun, and they tip in Europe. So I had like 200 euros by the end of the 2 days. So all of those that got the rewards, got the awards and everything was fine, but I had the money, so I bought them all lunch, so that was good. So who cares about awards anyway? So that shows you a little bit about what a festival is. And yeah, so ever since I got the, well, a few months ago, I got my green card. So now, no, it's bizarre because it's really, I did everything for that green card. I mean, that was the carrot, the carrot on the stick, and now I don't have to do that anymore, but obviously my life has now took a turn for the best, obviously. And so, yeah, that's me, I guess, yeah? Okay. I'm just gonna...
Thank you so much. Thank you so much for sharing your amazing